गुड आफ्टरनून मिस्टर सिंह, सुन रहे हैं?
या गुड आफ्टरनून, हाउ आर यू?
सर्वाइविंग टू स्टार्ट वन मिस्टर सिंह.
यू आर स्टार ऑफ टुडे शो एक्चुअली.
स्पीकर ऑफ टुडे, जस्ट टू शेयर सम एक्सपीरियंस.
सो स्पीकर ऑफ द डे इज बेसिकली अ स्टार फॉर अस.
टेंपरेरी.
थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर बीइंग हियर.
वेलकम सर, थैंक यू. माय प्लेजर.
लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू लिसनिंग टू यू.
होप यू विल फाइंड इट इंटरेस्टिंग इनफ.
I'm sure we only call people whom we think they are interesting. Nobody disappoints us actually. Have we met earlier?
Mr. Singh, I come to Delhi very occasionally, but I'm not sure that we met.
So we had many occasions to be together, sir, myself and Vishnath.
I thought a couple of years back someone like you was there in Stockholm, India, whatever, or something. You were not there.
Yeah, I was there, Mr. Singh. Yes.
Yeah. So I do remember. That means my memory is not that bad still. I used to be, I think, either additional secretary here or director general National Mission for Clean Ganga. So maybe 2017 or something, or maybe I am not very sure.
Yes, Mr. Singh, yes.
Because you have a personality which can't be forgotten so easily.
Yes. Long hair.
I wish I could also grow so much hair and the kind of beard you have.
This could be COVID effective, sir.
No. For him, it's not a COVID effect. I know. So, Anupama, are we ready?
Yes, sir. We are ready. So, with your due permission, shall we start the program?
Sure.
Welcome, everybody, to this 18th edition of Water Talk of the National Water Mission and the 5th of the E-Series. A warm welcome to the Secretary UP Singh, sir, who initiated this program long back in March 22nd, 2019. And just for the information of the people who have joined recently for this water talk, this was a series of talks initiated in 2019, March 22nd. And from there onwards, every month, third Friday, we used to have speakers who have done extremely well in the field of water, either as a professional theoretician or as a practitioner or a technical guide. You invite them and they used to give aspects on what they have done in the field and how successful it has been done in the field. After the outbreak of the pandemic, as per this direction of the Secretary, we shifted on to the e-platform. That had given us a much bigger audience and wider area of coverage. हमने पहले तो दिल्ली में ही करते थे, तो 200-300 लोग बुला के मीटिंग किया करते थे. अभी विद द एडवेंट ऑफ द ई वाटर टॉक फ्रॉम द अप्रैल ऑनवर्स, वी हैव गॉट पीपल अटेंडिंग दिस वाटर टॉक फ्रॉम वेरियस पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्री एज वेल एज इवन इंटरनेशनल पार्टिसिपेशन इज सीन. एंड ऑल्सो the number of participants attending the conference as this water talk has gone up. Last talk we had an approximately about 60 to 70,000 people watching our program through our various Facebook linkages as well as from the in the direct link. So this has really expanded the reach in terms of geographical area as well as numerical numbers. So we are very happy that we are providing a platform for people who have done so well in water conservation sector to put their programs for inspiring others all over the world and country. Today we have before we move on to today's program, I would like to say about two three words on the campaign which National Water Mission has been taking up. We have taken up this Catch the Rain campaign for the last 3 months, and the campaign is going on very well. We are requesting the states to take up rainwater harvesting structures in all parts of the country, particularly rooftop rainwater harvesting structures and the deepening of ponds or catching the rain in dug wells or the small lakes which are sort of slowly missing from the geographical boundary, and also reviving water bodies and rejuvenating our rivers. These are some of the suggestions we are given under the Catch the Rain campaign. And institutions which have large area, like the IITs, colleges, universities, armed forces, ordnance factories, and airports and railways, all of them have been brought in to conserve rainwater in their area, so that the water is stored for future use. And we contemplate two advantages of this Catch the Rain campaign. One, of course, is to conserve water, and second is for reducing the urban flooding. So that is why this speaker, Mr. Vishwanath, is very, very important for us, because he has been one of the major water catchers of Bangalore, I would say. Bangalore, they, Mr. Vishwanath and his team had started a program called Million Wells Movement in 2018 with the help of similar-minded people like the Friends of Lake, who been as the implementer, India Care Foundation, enabler and a fundraiser, and the Bionic Environmental Trust headed by Mr. Vishwanath as the technical support. So they had formed a team and tried to come up with an interesting solution to water, Bangalore's water problems. Bangalore city as you all knew, is a big city, and it has its own water, drinking water problem associated, even though it's getting a large quantity of water from River Kaveri. But since there was a lot of rains available in Bangalore, and there was shortage of water for drinking purpose, the movement which they started, called the Million Wells Movement in 2018, tried to store and capture water, rainwater in the wells, and almost 1 lakh wells have been revived or dug in Bangalore area to recharge the shallow aquifers. And the success has really been very, very phenomenal. And not only the water table has gone up and water conservation has improved in Bangalore city, he also provided livelihood to about 750 people of the Bohi tribe, which were the traditional well diggers. So it is basically a livelihood as well as conservation of water program combined together, and it has showed remarkable success. So Mr. Vishwanathan Srikant Iyer, our speaker today, is a holder of master's degree in urban and regional planning from CEPT Ahmedabad, and also a postgraduate diploma in urban environmental management from the Rotterdam University, Netherlands. So he is presently the director of Biome Environmental Solutions Private Limited, an NGO specializing in earth architecture and sustainable water and energy design. So this is a very interesting talk, because he would definitely come up with various innovative solutions his organization had come up in Bangalore and very successfully implemented. So the idea of this talk is to see how new structures and innovations were brought in to harvest the rainwater and use the conserved water to increase the water table. With these words, I request Mr. Vishwanath Srikant Iyer to take forward his presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ashok Kumar. I'll start to share my presentation. Yeah, I think that's full screen now. I'll just sort of commence my presentation. Thank you for the nice words of introduction. It's not my work that I'm going to present today as much as the work of the ecosystem of solution providers in Bangalore, including institutions, the state, and citizens. So that's the way I'm going to present it. Is there an echo for you, Mr. Ashok Kumar?
Okay. Yes, there is an echo, actually.
Yeah, I'm just wondering why. Okay, I think now it's clear.
Yeah.
Fine. So this talk is about a brief history of the city of Bangalore and its relationship with water. engagements of the institutions with the challenges that the institutions face in ensuring water for all here. Also, engagement of community apartments and individuals with some solutions, right? So what we recognize in Indian cities now is that it's not sufficient for the institution alone to be able to provide all the solutions. Community participation is at the heart of finding sustainability for solutions. And it's in the ideal partnership between institutions and communities, and including individuals, that we'll be able to overcome the challenges of water and wastewater management in our urban areas. So I'll also dwell a bit on the wastewater challenge and some solutions which the city of Bangalore is positing, and the likely way forward as to how we are going to approach these challenges in the coming years. So one of the stories in the media, which had been there for the last 2 years in 2018, was this fact that Bangalore is going to run out of groundwater. Somehow it also got touted as the city to run out of water itself, and that it would be the next Cape Town. Right. So this was the scenario presented in the media. And generally, what sometimes happens with these panic stories is that we lose our head. I mean, we don't respond in a logical fashion. So it's important to understand, is it a fact that we're going to run out of water? And if it's genuinely so, then we can take steps to do it. But if it's not so, then we have to address that issue in a more pragmatic fashion and a more balanced fashion. So I would assume, and I think as a citizen of Bangalore, that we're not going to run out of water. There's a distribution issue, there's an access issue, but we have to learn to manage it better and better as we go along. That's the more pragmatic way of looking at things. So what is fascinating for me is that the geology of a city seems to have a very important role in how its groundwater is. So for this Bangalore city of ours, has a 3,500-year-old history. I'm sorry why it's jumping around. And therefore, what happened 3,500 years ago with granite and gneiss and volcanic eruptions now has still a role to play in our city. What it does is it determines the aquifer, both the shallow and confined aquifer, which is weathered, and also the deeper aquifer, which is in cracks and fissures of rocks. And then that gives us accessibility to water. To understand geology is crucial for us in our cities now. What we have to see also, as we go along, is again other interesting facets of geology that happen. The continental drift has had a major role to play in the Indian subcontinent as it moves into the Asian plate, right? And it's created the Himalayas, which has then become responsible for the monsoon. It's also caused the sinking of the Indo-Gangetic belt, you know, tectonically long years back. And therefore, the Indo-Gangetic belt has become the most fertile area of the world, from all the way from the Indus Valley to Bangladesh, then you see the Sindhu River, and all the way to Bangladesh. This is the most fertile area of the world since centuries, and also the most frequent and the most populated area of the world, right? So this is the place where the population is the highest. So this is one aspect of geology and the continental drift which has played a major role in the Indian water scenario. The other interesting fact for my city, Bangalore, is that when the Indian plate separated from the African plate, Madagascar as an island, it left behind a portion of the Western Ghats, the Sahyadris. That portion of the Western Ghats is called the Palghat Gap. And it's very interesting. You see on the table on the right that if you look at the rainfall pattern, in April and May, the city of ours gets a lot of rainfall. It's a substantial amount of rainfall, whereas the rest of the country is sweltering under the heat of summer, peak heat of summer. And that's because this Palghat Gap gives an opening for the hot, humid air from the Arabian Sea to rush in, drift upwards, come to Bangalore city, and pour in the evening. And this is called the office rain, very colloquially in Bangalore, because at 5 o'clock or 5:30, when the offices are to close, the thunderstorms arrive and then it starts to pour, right? And then people find it difficult to go home. So again, a part of continental drift has played an impact now, because if you look at it, it creates a bimodal peak for Bangalore. May is the peak again, and September, October become the second peak. And therefore, it makes it easier to harvest rain because of the well-distributed pattern of rainfall, accidental of geology, accident of the continental plate, which is what's happening. A more recent history has been the establishment of the British cantonment from 1806 to 1881. The British established a cantonment. And so ideas of piped water and piped underground sewerage came to the city with this establishment of the cantonment in the theoretical sense. The city also has, in memory, in 1876 to 78, three years of drought, which caused all the lakes to dry up. So when we talk about local resources as a source for water, we should also remember that local resources are susceptible to climate change and sometimes are inadequate. They can be a major supplement to water requirements, but cannot be the whole water supplier. And so this drought and famine of 1876 and 78 caused the city fathers to think through and decide on a reliable and sustainable water supply. And so therefore they began the work in 1894 of what's called the Hesargatta Reservoir on the river Arkavati, about 24 kilometers from Bangalore. So for the first time, Bangalore said that its local lakes and tanks are insufficient for water, especially during a drought. Therefore, it has to reach out, and it reached out in the form of technology. So 1894-96, we used steam engines to pump water from Hesargatta to the city, 22 kilometers. The first instance that I can recall of steam engines being used at such scale to bring water to a city. So technology becomes the driver for water solutions from 1894-1896. And these were wood-fired steam engines, by the way. Then in 1911, electricity came to the city of Bangalore. And electricity was first used to pump water again in the city of Bangalore from the same Hesargatta Lake, because this was a new power, and there it brought water. So again, technology as a solution has been in the brain of the city for a long, long time, for more than 100 years now. And then engineering solutions like the Ganesh Iyer siphon, civil engineers would be happy to note these kind of developments, which is a volute siphon. It's a special siphon, Ganesh Iyer siphon, to check, get the overflow from that Hesargatta reservoir to go without a large wear, right? So these experiments were also being tried out. This is in the 1930s. So we have a history of planning for water from the 1890s, which includes steam and electricity and pumped water and piped water from the city. The plague in Bangalore from 1896 to 1899 started the expansion of planned localities and sewerage networks. Planned localities had started to come up, but then it started to come up in a bigger way fashion. And sewerage was paid attention to, because sanitation was identified as the root cause for the plague, and therefore clean sanitation then became a drive from 1896 to 1899. And for us, luckily again, in 1964, the first specialized water supply and sewerage board in India was the Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board. 1964, it celebrated its 50th year about 5 years, 6 years back. We are 56 years old. The first specialized water supply institution in India was created. And the Kaveri was identified as a source. The Kaveri River, mind you, is 100 kilometers from Bangalore and about 300 meters below the city. So it required an engineering feat to get the water to our city, and therefore an institution which was specialized was created. And so there you are in terms of the catchment, the river basin. Bangalore finds itself peculiarly positioned on a ridge. So half of Bangalore is in the Kaveri basin and half is in what's called the Dakshin Pinakin basin. There are four reservoirs on the Kaveri in Karnataka, KRS, Kabini, which I show here, and Hemavati and Harangi, too, which I don't show. But these reservoirs are crucial for the city of Bangalore, because these reservoirs hold the water, which then comes to the city and is pumped up there. As you can see on the right, it's pumped up by about 100 kilometers, 95 kilometers and about 300 meters above the city, making Bangalore's water one of the costliest in Asia. The production cost of water, delivered cost of water, if you include capital cost, O&M cost, and sinking fund, is 95 rupees a kiloliter, right? So 95 rupees a kiloliter is a very costly piece of water. And it takes 2 units of energy to get 1 kiloliter of water to the city of Bangalore. So embodied energy is also very high. Therefore, the carbon emission is also very high. On the other hand, the city gets lucky because it's on a ridge. Therefore, management of sewerage becomes easier because the flows of the valleys are out from the city. Therefore, it becomes easier to lay sewerage line. The natural drainage takes water out of the city. And so therefore, we keep a close eye on the reservoir levels of the Kaveri at all points of time. As a concerned citizen or as even an institution, we should keep an eye on those four reservoirs, number 4, 5, 6, and 7, and look at the life storage on a day-to-day basis. Especially in summertime, you have to make sure that there's 1.8 TMC feet of water available every month, because that's the demand of water for Bangalore city alone. As you can see, that the position in May itself was pretty comfortable. But then, reservoir management is crucial to the drinking water supply of the city, and the kind of interaction between reservoir managers and the city water suppliers is not really very firm and needs to be firmed up as we go along. So, what is the resource that we tap into? We tap into 1,450 million liters per day, which is now currently pumped in into Bangalore, and another 775 million liters per day is supposed to come in the coming 3 years through a large project which is being taken up. Now, if you look at the key debates that come in the media and in the narratives, is that the city somehow takes away the water which is meant for agriculture or irrigation use. But if you look at Bangalore city's population in the Kaveri Basin, 50% of the population of Karnataka in the Kaveri Basin is in the city of Bangalore. But the water it takes from the reservoirs is only 11% of Karnataka's allocation, right? So in terms of equity, there still is equity because larger population is getting only a lesser volume of water. And mind you, of the 11% that is taken and pumped into the city, 80% of it flows as wastewater and is then again treated or untreated used by farmers. So net-net, Bangalore is only using 2% of Karnataka's allocation for consumption. So my argument would be that cities are the most efficient users of water. And if cities plan for water well, the treated wastewater can be a very good resource for agricultural use. And the third point is that the economic benefits that come from cities' use of water is one of the highest because 60% of the GDP of Karnataka comes from the city of Bangalore. And you can argue that this 1,450 MLD is Bangalore's lifeline. And the 60% of the GDP of the state is dependent on that 1,450 MLD. Therefore, it should have the topmost priority in terms of water receiving and distribution. Rainwater in the city is, on the other hand, the equivalent of 3,000 million liters per day. Lakes I have left as a gap because I'll discuss why, what role lakes will play. My argument is that lakes cannot be sources of water. They can be sources of recharge of groundwater. They can be ecological spots and social spots, but they shouldn't be seen as drinking water sources in the Bangalore context. Groundwater is a very important source. About 400 to 500 MLD is drawn daily from groundwater. There's not enough focus on groundwater recharge and groundwater management, and it will gradually come. The city of Bangalore has more than 400,000 borewells. It could be as high as 500,000 borewells. So 400 to 500,000 borewells are drawing 400 to 500 billion liters per day, which augments the pipe water supply. And wastewater is increasingly likely to become a resource, but it will not be a resource for the city as much as for the drought-prone hinterland as things go along. So the city cannot look at it itself in isolation. It has to look at the requirements of water of the farmers surrounding the city, and the hinterland and the city together have to plan for water as we go forward. So we have a historical luckiness to it all. We have 1 million connections in the city by the BWSSB, which delivers water to about roughly 2 million households, connecting 9 to 10 million people out of the 12 to 13 million people. So about 75 to 80% of the people are connected to the water utility network. And for them, water shortage is not really an issue. It may be a local issue, but it's not really an issue. So Bangalore's not going to run out of water. Of course, we need more democratization in terms of the discussions of water distribution and its equity at ward committee level. That has to come in future. And the big challenge for the city has been the periphery of the city, the 7 city municipal councils and 1 town municipal council, plus 110 villages which were amalgamated into the city to become the Brihad Bangalore. From Bangalore Mahanagar Palika, it became the Brihad Bangalore Mahanagar Palika. And it's the periphery that became the challenge for water supply network as well as for wastewater collection, and continues to be so. So again, the city has to quickly think of the periphery, the new periphery that is emerging, and to include that in planning for now. It cannot just concentrate on the metropolitan area. It has to always imagine the future and plan for larger and larger areas to be ready. So the lucky thing for Bangalore is it's one of the few cities in India which is actually metered. All the 1 million collections are metered, and there is a volumetric tariff, and there is a person who comes to the household every month to read the meter. We have an increasing block tariff and a differential tariff. There's a domestic tariff, there's a non-domestic tariff, and there's an industrial tariff. And this is the first city in India which actually charges for borewell on premises. I am not aware of any other city which charges for borewell. So if you have a borewell in your house, you are charged 100 rupees a month as sanitary cess. The argument being that you take the borewell water and you push it into the sewer network, and the city has to collect it and treat it. Right? And if it's in a flat, let's say if there are 10 flats and there's one borewell, actually 100 rupees is charged for every flat. So the 10 flats will pay 1,000 rupees for that one borewell, right? So there is in one way a charge on borewell and on groundwater, and another way a count of the actual number of borewells which are existing in the city, and the number is close to 300,000. 300,000 borewells, and the BWSSB collects a phenomenal amount of sanitary cess. Ideally, we should go towards metering the borewells, insisting on a meter, and then putting a volumetric tariff. But that's a bit of a persuasion, and that's a bit of communication that has to go on. Now, the increasing block tariff also has a pro-poor element to it. 0 to 8,000 liters is charged at 7 rupees per kiloliter. And if you get a pro-poor connection is if you have a 600 square feet or less house, you only pay 25% of the normal connection charge. And you'll always get a bill at the lowest slab of the domestic tariff, which is to say at 7 rupees per kiloliter. So it's important to get metering done, volumetric tariff done, but to include the human right to water and a pro-poor policy, and to manage groundwater, which is what successfully Bangalore has been able to do from the 1930s onwards, a lesson for others. And so this is another list. So there's a proposal to increase the tariff, which is coming along. tariff increases are not commensurate with the expense increase, especially of electricity, because it's a politically tough decision. And we have to find a way around this tough decisions that we need to take to make sure that the institution is financially stable. Because if the institution is not financially stable, then the challenge is that it cannot do the operations and maintenance or the repairs regularly. It cannot plan for capital projects. And it cannot have a future outlook because it's financially unstable and is dependent on loans or grants from various international and national institutions. So one of the key challenges, of course, is that it's not the price of water per se, which is what keeps the poor from accessing it. It's the connection charge. And so the barrier to connection charge can be a legal barrier. It can be a financial barrier. The legal barrier has been overcome in Bangalore because it says that if you have any identification, a ration card, an electricity bill, or anything, you don't have to have proof of occupation of a space, you're entitled to a connection charge. But the financial affordability charge is only push universalization of connections in the future. And that's it's a financial decision also, as much as it's a political decision. And we are faced with the fact that it's rupees 95 per kiloliter of production cost, and that's a huge cost. How do you recover it becomes a challenge, because you cannot recover all of it from cross subsidies from industries and non-domestic charges as much as you try, because they substitute the pipe water with groundwater. So therefore, the overall concept of integrated urban water management then comes into play. How can institutions and cities think of IUWM? Should it be that the institution supplying water has to think of IUWM, or should a set of policies come into place which makes IUWM possible, with the Bangalore Water Supply and Sewerage Board as one of the partners or players in it? And you know the IUWM concept, which says look at rainwater, pipe water, wastewater, and groundwater holistically and plan for all of these together as part of the city's resources, right? And so here comes the role of institutions in this IUWM process. We have something called the Karnataka State Natural Disaster Monitoring Center. This was the drought monitoring center set up in Karnataka, again, one of the first in India, which became the Karnataka State Natural Disaster Monitoring Center. We have the Groundwater Authority, which has a place to play in terms of the groundwater management and understanding. The Karnataka Tank Conservation Development Authority, which is in charge of the lakes of Bangalore, and the State Pollution Control Board as regulators. Now, all of these are key players along with the BWSSB for IUWM, for integrated water management. Now, here's the KSNDMK. This is one of my favorite organizations. It's done substantially solid work, and it's been a great asset to the water management of the city. The Karnataka State Natural Disaster Monitoring Center has this sort of app. It's called the Mega Sandesha app. It's a bit unclear, I'm sorry about that, but it tells you real time on the rainfall that is occurring in the city. It has 99 meteorological stations in the city, 99 weather stations in the city, very granulated. It's aiming for 196 in the city. So we now have granular data at world level of the intensity of rainfall, total volume of rainfall, and flood prediction. So now they work to a live inundation map here on this app called Mega Sandesha, and the rainfall data is also available. So therefore, you're now able to design both stormwater and flooding management systems as well as rainwater harvesting systems based on granular data and recent intensity of rainfall. Just to give you an example, the original intensity of rainfall estimated for Bangalore was about 60 millimeters per hour, but recent data seems to suggest that for 15-minute period, it goes as high as 180 millimeters per hour. 180 millimeters per hour and 60 millimeters per hour, that's an ocean of difference. And this kind of data generation by KSNDMC therefore helps in terms of better planning and better management of rainwater and stormwater. So bylaws and regulations by themselves have addressed rainwater harvesting, wastewater recycling, groundwater management, metering in every house, and automatic switch off pumps. And these are very progressive bylaws and regulations, and I'm sure that many cities in India will start to follow this. For example, this is the establishment of sewage treatment plants. Any set of 20 apartments or more, or 2,000 square meters and more, has to compulsorily have a sewage treatment plant and to reuse the sewage with dual plumbing and to use it for toilet flushing and non-potable use. So this is mandatory in the city of Bangalore. Then there is a notification which demands internal meters. If you have a set of flats more than four, each flat should have a meter. It's not that the BWSSB will come and read it, but the apartment association or the residents association can make use of this metering, which is mandated, and therefore charge based on volumetric consumption. And it's also obligatory to provide automatic water level control system. Every sump and overhead tank must have this automatic water level control system so that you don't have tanks overflowing and water getting wasted. This is again a progressive regulation. It's now gradually being implemented. Then there's the rainwater harvesting regulation. This has come through the study, detailed study of the rainfall pattern, the daily rainfall pattern, and the daily water balance. And what it says is, that for every square meter of roof area, you must create a 60 liters of storage or recharge. And for every square meter of paved area around a building, 30 liters of storage or recharge per day's rainfall. And the minimum depth of a recharge structure should be 3 meters. You could have a recharge well, you could have a recharge bore well, or you could have a sump tank. The option is yours. But these numbers have been arrived at to both control flooding as well as to augment aquifer and to augment the cities. About 135,000 buildings in Bangalore have done rainwater harvesting of various degrees of efficiency. The number is picking up. So the conceptual framework for rainwater harvesting in a city, is everybody knows, rooftop rainwater is perhaps the cleanest and can easily be filtered and either stored or recharged. Landscape water, as I'll show you in some examples, can be filtered and recharged into the aquifer. Major stormwater drains need to have biological filters, and they can feed the lakes and tanks and therefore recharge the aquifer and then go through it. It's a simple conceptual framework. The idea in the city is every roof has a catchment. Why not imagine every roof has a catchment? And therefore, the roof should be as clean so that you can put a banana leaf and eat a meal out of it. So it's as simple as keeping rooftops clean and designed. And the easiest way to harvest rainwater is to stick a rain barrel, like what I showed you on the left figure. It's just a 500 liter storage tank. And if the roof is kept clean and swept and dusted, then what you find is the water bottle on the right, which is actually potable water. Now you can check it for BIS 10500. The only element of contamination you can find is biological contamination through bacteria. And so there are simple filters that will be able to help you to overcome that contamination and to drink it. So if the catchment is clean, if the filtration is good, rainwater can be of the greatest quality from rooftops, which is what you have to keep in mind. And so industries do it, individual homes do it, apartments do it. This is an industry harvesting rainwater. The advantage with rainwater is it comes with embodied energy. So if you stock it up at a high place, you don't need to pump, you can use gravity and consume it, right? So then comes the next issue with rainwater and groundwater as an interface. The city of Bangalore has a ridge line running through it. The ridge line, as you see, is the dotted line. To the left, you'll see the Arkavati or the Kaveri Valley, and to the right is the Dakshin Pinakini River. The Dakshin Pinakini is the river which enters the Bay of Bengal independently. There's a very nice difference here, both in terms of hydrology and hydrogeology. To the left, you'll find a dendritic system which flows from north to south. So the lakes and tanks here are shallow and deep. To the right, you'll find it flowing more from west to east. It's a very shallow flow. And these lakes here are shallow lakes, but large and widespread lakes. The geology is also different. In the Dakshin Pinakini, the geology addresses a clay layer which emerges at 20 to 30 feet. So therefore, recharge is a bit difficult. But on the left, the Arkavati Valley, recharge is very high. It can go into the deeper aquifer. So even in a city, you can have very localized differences in hydrology and hydrogeology. That has to be taken into account as we design groundwater recharge structure. At a basic unit level of a site, a small site of, let's say, 100 square meters or 200 square meters, here's what the difference is in Bangalore. If it's an unbuilt site as the one on the left, 10% of the rainfall runs off and joins the stormwater drainage system. 85% of the rainfall, annual rainfall, is held in the 1 meter soil depth and is either evaporated or evapotranspired. About 3 to 8% enters the aquifer and becomes groundwater, whether unconfined aquifer or the confined aquifer slowly and gradually. But the moment the site is built upon, and I'm talking about a small site, the runoff coefficient goes from 10 to 95%. Recharge is virtually zero because people tend to pave the whole area. And evaporation losses is about 5% because the roofs and paved areas are heated. So what we've done is taken a 10% runoff or perhaps a 15% runoff to 95%. We've increased the urban flooding from one site by a factor of 9, right? So this is one of the major causes of urban flooding. Apart from the encroachment of low-lying areas and wetlands and lakes, the high significant increase in runoff coefficient is one major criteria, as well as the intensity of rainfall, which is increasing with urbanization. So the idea with rainwater harvesting is to get to biomimicry and to replace the built-up site with the hydrological cycle of the unbuilt site. That's the philosophy. And so this has been a city of lakes and wells. So it's called Kere and Bavi in Kannada. So the lakes would fill up, they would recharge the shallow aquifer, and it would become available as filtered water in the wells. The wells would provide the drinking water. Still 1894, 1896, this was the method of water harvesting, recharge, and draw and use. And there was this wonderful community called the Manvaddas or the Bovi people. And these are the people who dug the wells and the lakes. They've been digging it for 1,000 years all across India. They're called the Od, the Vadda, the Vadera. The different names across other places. These are the people who dug the Upper Ganga Canal, the Upper Yamuna Canal. All these canal projects were also done by this community, which has a specialized skill in earthwork. They still exist in Bangalore, about 750 families who continue to clean wells, deepen wells, desilt wells, put potassium permanganate, alum, and clean it up also, and dig new wells. So now, through the rainwater harvesting policy and bylaw, the people have another livelihood opportunity because now they dig recharge wells in addition to cleaning up the old wells. And they learned the new trick of recharge wells. And so the idea is that wherever old wells exist in the city, can we make sure that they come back to life, that they are cleaned up? And then in the surrounding areas of these old open wells, newer wells are dug, which are recharge wells, and we expand the zone where shallow unconfined aquifer water can be used. Right? So the localities with the wells have been mapped. All the old localities have plentiful wells, and we estimate that there are 10,000 open wells which are still functional with good clean water. One of the challenges, of course, is that leaking sewage lines can contaminate these wells. The other thing is that if a well dries up, people tend to fill it up. But if we revive the memory of the well and clean up the sewage line, then it's possible that all these shallow aquifers can be brought to life. So the modern idea is to pick rooftop rainwater, as Mr. Balasubramanian is doing on the left, through the pipe, filter the water in charcoal, and leave it into the open well itself, that which is the tarpaulin-covered blue sheet, which you see on the left. Or on the right, you see these small shallow open wells. Now, these two wells provide all the water required for the household for the whole year. And something like a 10,000 such wells are doing that for the whole year. Now, here's the advantage. The open well consumes 0.1 unit of electricity for 1,000 liters, as compared to Kaveri, which is 2 units of power. The open well, therefore, has the least embodied energy. It has the lowest cost water and is therefore the most affordable. And if it can be plugged with rainwater harvesting and recharge, then it can be the cheapest source of water and the most reliable in a particular locality. And so that's what we try to grow. So in Kabban Park, which is at the heart of the city, 220 acres, discovered through the Manwadar community and the park gardeners, old wells which had gone defunct, 7 of them were revived, including what's called the Karagadabhavi, which is a traditional well, the one on the left bottom. The festival of Karaga, which begins in Bangalore, also makes a pit stop at this place and puts homage to it. So it's a real religious cultural artifact, also as much as a functional artifact. And these wells, which are revived and with 70 recharge wells put in the whole park, they provide 1 lakh liters of water a day, right? So the park is now very much dependent on shallow aquifer water for its water requirement. Or the Wheeland Active Plant, we're led by a remarkable gentleman called Ajay Kumar Singh, who's an environmental officer, who stepped in and prevented the dumping of slag and waste material around the wetlands in the premises of the campus, cleaned up those old wells, and now they have 6 old open wells, which provide them 3 lakh liters of water. The wetland has been revived, all the rainwater comes to that place, and they are independent of the BWSSB for all their water requirements. And so some remarkable work which has been done by industries there. Or institutions like the Indian Institute of Management, which has put in place something like 65 recharge wells. It picks storm water and puts it into these recharge wells, as you see there. And therefore, the groundwater table has come up, and the borewell now is yielding much more water than it used to do before. So it's possible for individual homes, parks, institutions, industries. This is how a recharge well is dug. You see the Manwadar there. It digs about 20 feet to 30 feet deep, and then puts in these precast concrete rings. And then that's it. And then there's a slab on top to cover it so that it's safe and secure. And then if the recharge wells are done better at a layout level. Now, if you look at a gated community like Rainbow Drive, which is on Sarjapur Road in Bangalore, this is 360 plots on 36 acres of land, right? They could easily have had 360 bore wells drawing water from each one of the plots because they're not connected to the water utility, which means 2 lakh rupees per bore well. So 7.2 crore rupees or 72 million rupees for 360 straws going into the same Coca-Cola bottle and then emptying it completely. On the other hand, what the layout did was they said, let's treat groundwater as a common pool resource. So they banned private bore wells on their own as a resident association. They mandated recharge wells. So now they have 3 bore wells, which provide all the water which they need, but 300 odd recharge wells, which push in all the water. They put in place a metering system. They put in place a tariff system. So they dropped demand to less than 23,000 liters per month. They picked up all the wastewater and they treated it as on the top left in a pyTorrent system set up by NIRI. And the treated wastewater is now supplied to every one of the homes free of cost. So it meets all the landscape requirement and the non-potable requirement. And with that, they have become net water positive, right? What they do is they put in more water into the aquifer than they draw from it, right? That's what we call as net water positivity locally. So what was crucial was communitization of groundwater, metering, tariff, and wastewater design. So this is in fact IUWM being practiced at a gated community level. So they have become an exemplar. Many societies now visit them, learn from them, and start to imitate them. So a lot more societies are doing the same thing. But what's crucial to do is it's not just a matter of rainwater harvesting or groundwater recharge. You have to do a water balance calculation, as I showed here, and to understand what is current demand, then put in the numbers. You find that the demand for water was 246 liter per capita per day, which is a very high demand. So when we brought it to the residents, they worked out a tariff system, and so they got it down to 150. Actually, now the per capita demand is less than 100 LPCV, right? So if you get the water balance right, if you get the pricing right, and if you understand the rainwater and the water balance together at a community level, it's possible to make these communities water independent. So more communities that become water independent, the better for the city, right? The question is, how can these systems be incentivized by the state is something that we'll have to look at. So this is the pytorate wastewater treatment system set up by NIRI. It does a good job of gravity-based treatment that's applied to all the households. And there's the other layout called Classic Orchards. This is a larger one, 70 acres. They clean up their old well, this huge well, which is there, 100 to 120 truckloads of silt was removed, and then it was all put into the gardens of people. The silt was used, and then the well is now full of water. And they did a huge bunch of recharge. So actually, groundwater can give them 6 to 8 months of water. So again, gated communities are ideal places to put in place water management system if they so want, and if the residents association is strong. Now come to apartments. This is one of my favorite apartments, TZ Apartments, led by a remarkable bunch of individuals, including Mr. Shekhar, who was there, who was one of the residents. What they've done is they've put in place recharge structures, 40 recharge wells as the picture in the center, but also they have put in place a wastewater treatment system which takes it to a sand filter, activated carbon filter, an ozonizer, and an RO system. And there on the right is the ex-chairman of the Pollution Control Board drinking the wastewater. So this is the first community in India that I know of which actually takes treated wastewater, blends it with groundwater, and drinks it. Right? Now, these are 94 flats and villas. There are doctors in there, and they themselves have overcome the yuck factor, have shown belief in science and treatment system, and are doing it. So these are now exemplars which the city has to start to follow. And then reviving lakes and recharge wells, it then becomes the norm. Whole bunch of activists in the city have been pushing both the state as well as the courts to get into the matter and start to protect lakes and tanks and clean them up. So here's what happens with the lakes and tank movement. There are three major valleys in the city, and these three major valleys have a lot of tanks in them. And so one of the chain of tanks which I'm showing to you on the right is the one in the center called the Jakur Lake, right? So the Jakur Lake has 18.9 square kilometers. And this was one of the first lakes which demonstrated, thanks to a residents association and partnership with institutions, as to what could be done with treated wastewater and a lake. So the figure on the right tells you that there's a wastewater treatment plant, which is a 15 MLD wastewater treatment plant. Below that is a constructed wetland, and below that is the lake. And I'll show you the photograph. Now, this is how the lake looks like from upstream, where the wastewater treatment plant is. And I'm taking a photograph from the wastewater treatment plant. The treated wastewater comes into a constructed wetland, like so. This is a constructed wetland, which is about 7 acres in diameter. This constructed wetland polishes the treated wastewater, as well as some amount of untreated wastewater that comes in. And that's the clarity of the water which flows in into the lake, right? The lake then provides opportunity for livelihoods like fishing. The sludge in the STP, the truckload of sludge, sells for 10,000 rupees. Actually, wastewater treatment plants can be designed to be energy generating on their own for about 70 to 80%, and the sludge can be a revenue source. The treated wastewater, of course, can be a revenue source, but importantly, a livelihood source, as in this particular case. The lake is now full with treated wastewater as well as rainwater, and then it's provided livelihoods for a lot of people. So livelihoods as an approach, fishermen, well diggers, you know, farmers, that's the way to go for the city. This is the bunch of well diggers who have been recharging the lake, making sure that the wells are dug and so on and so forth. And the real challenge now is in small sites with large things. So what is the lesson for apartments? So the lesson for apartments is harvest rainwater, meter every flat, recycle wastewater and reuse it as much as possible, but rejuvenate lakes in the surrounding areas, because the aquifer is independent of your apartment. It's a larger being. So if you rejuvenate local lakes, it will help you. Regulate groundwater, make it common pool, and strengthen groundwater management. And so therefore, the BWSSB or any state utility or the groundwater authority now has to step in to incentivize these kind of groundwater management systems in place. So the last point that I want to talk to you is that the city generates a lot of wastewater. What should be done with the wastewater? Here, the city is running one of the largest transfer of treated wastewater for agriculture use purpose. This is 440 MLD going into one valley called the Kormangala Chalagatta Valley. 450 MLD is being treated in wastewater treatment plant, and then it's being pumped 50 kilometers. It's now filling up one tank after the other. About 65 tanks have been filled up. That's treated wastewater entering a lake called Lakshmi Sagara. On the right is the lake full of treated wastewater. And then it flows by gravity, as you see from these minor irrigation department PowerPoint photographs, that they fill up tanks one after the other, the cascading series of tanks with treated wastewater. And as the cascading effect takes place, the wastewater quality continuously improves thanks to ecological regeneration. Then it can be picked up, as on the left, from this lake called Narsapura and pumped to another set of tanks. And slowly, 137 tanks will be filled up. Farmers are not allowed to draw water directly from the tanks. It's allowed to recharge the groundwater, and they can pick up the groundwater and use it for irrigation purpose, right? And so, therefore, aquifer recharge is happening all along the tank. Open wells are filling up. Farmers are using drip irrigation systems and growing a pallet of crops with this. There's a constant monitoring of the quality of the treated wastewater by a committee set up by the NGT and the Supreme Court. There was a case which had gone all the way to Supreme Court, and it's been cleared by the Supreme Court with certain stringent regulatory conditions. All those are being followed. And this is going to be a lesson on how to manage wastewater for hinterland use for the rest of India also. Many other cities are already planning to do it and are already doing it. So the new compact has to be between cities and the region. Now, if you transfer all the treated wastewater from Bangalore, about 64,000 hectares of land can be irrigated with drip irrigation systems. So you're going to make it climate change and drought resistant grow. Therefore, corporate social responsibility is also now stepping in. BEL, Bharat Electronics Limited, has invested 13.5 crores, set up a 10 MLD wastewater treatment plant, just like the Jaipur model, and is rejuvenating a lake close to itself called the Dodabamasandra Lake. The project is just likely to get inaugurated any time. And so with the 10 MLD, it takes 2 MLD for itself as part of the treated wastewater, therefore to ensure quality. And with that 2 MLD, it recovers all the investment costs in a matter of 3.5 to 4 years. 8 MLD comes to the lake as a community resource, fills up the lake, recharges the aquifer, and becomes available to the community at large. These kind of partnerships also need to be fostered, which is happening in the Bangalore context. And then there's the entrepreneurship ecosystem. Now, this is fascinating because this will be the future for India. Rainwater filters are being developed by entrepreneurs. Rainwater harvesting systems are being put in place by well diggers and other entrepreneurs. Wastewater treatment systems are being developed by entrepreneurs, recycling also. Smart meters are coming in. Designing IUWM at community scale, like at the gated community scale, is becoming a skill of design. So there are water designers who now can design for communities and help them get IUWM practice. Aquifer mapping and management is also slowly stepping in. Slowly. So there are these smart water meter websites you can take, or wastewater website. The second one actually takes wastewater and turns it to drinking water for communities. It offers it as a service. The smart water meters are also offering it as a service where you don't pay the true cost of the meter, but also just pay a monthly revenue model. So integrated urban water management, as is practiced in a city, may be better understood as an ecosystem, not like a physical plan or a project. It will require a lot of actors to be nudged and coordinated rather than directed in a project mode. We should imagine systems as not water supply institutions as much as systems design thinking institutions, who think of water system and wastewater system, look at the various parts and make sure that they're all coordinated in action. And citizens' role is not just partnership alone, which is very important, but also a watchdog role to make sure that the state sees, is accountable, right, at all points of time, holding the state accountable. So finally, the last 2 points that I want to make is that it calls for a social, technical, institutional, financial, legal, and environmental effort to make IUWM possible. Access, universal access, consideration to gender, especially when it comes to toilets and sanitation, where every individual household should have toilets. Community toilets should be available at all places. Public toilets should be available for women and for the handicapped and physically challenged. Inclusiveness, participation. These are key aspects of social interventions. The technical interventions have to be appropriate, you know, fit for purpose wastewater treatment plants. If you're going to use treated wastewater for agriculture, do you really need to strip it of phosphates and nitrates, is a question that you want to ask. But if you want to use it for drinking purpose, what should be the standards that you need to put in place? Institutional level thinking. We don't have river basin level institutions. If we don't get them very quickly, planning for a city within the river basin will become a challenge. And that will be the key challenge between cities' growth and the use of water. So river basin institutions should emerge, multidisciplinary institutions, hydrogeology, community engagers are crucial. Financial aspects. We will have to look at the human right to water, but we'll have to look at economic pricing of water so that institutions which provide water are financially sustainable. The legal architecture has to be redefined both for groundwater, rainwater harvesting, and for wastewater use. And finally, the environment emerges as a subset of all these interventions because protection of biodiversity is crucial to the management of water. It cannot only be seen as an anthropocentric thing. So we've set up a website called bengaluru.urbanwaters.in. Now that Bengaluru can be replaced by any city, can be pune.urbanwaters.in, newdelhi.urbanwaters.in. What we want to seek is that, can data and information be put up in public domain, for example, rainfall patterns, for example, service providers, groundwater management tools and experiences. So if we put open source data on all these entrepreneurship ecosystem, community ecosystem, individual success stories, institutional responses, I think we will be the better for all this information and data, and we'll do a great job of managing India's urban water success. Thank you. This is all I had to share, and let's all join hands in the great journey of water literacy, which has already been taken up by the ministry, and hopefully each one of us concerned citizens can become a part of the movement. Thank you very much.
Thank you, it is very interesting how technology, legal frame, community participation, all coming together to look at this integrated urban water management. And actually the true to the sense of the word integrated, all sorts of water have been properly connected, and the how the treated water is being used for inter area agriculture purposes. So there is a, I think there brings in a lot of ownership for the water, because otherwise people don't tend to take water seriously. Here you put in a system where entire community is owning up, and then they have a sense of responsibility towards water. And probably you are blessed in Bangalore with the type of populace you have there, technically technologically enlightened set of people, and set of people who are otherwise also enlightened to use this water. The way that you are showing the doctors and engineers living in that part of the apartment, treating the water and then consuming that water, it's a great significant mind block which has to be overcome. I remember in Singapore, the Prime Minister had to come on TV and bring the water live to show it as it's a new water when they introduced in 2005. So it's a very interesting model, and your solution for using this wastewater as a revenue generation is very, very interesting, because most of the urban water bodies, urban water supply boards, are having tremendous problem of resource generation. Many of them are in red because of the cost of water is very high. The treated water which they get in Hyderabad, I can tell you, they bring from Godavari, which is about 186 kilometers away, and from Krishna, which is about 108 kilometers away. Three projects from Krishna and one from Godavari. It's a huge cost of energy. We used to pay about 60, 70 crores every month as electricity charges only for this pumping water. So the cost of water is very high. And unfortunately, these treated water, when we come to your home, many people now use ROs to actually filter away 80% of that and waste it out. That is a challenge which we are facing. But as you rightly said, a marriage of technology, legal framework, and community participation is very important. And metering of individual apartment is a very, very interesting concept, because what happens in most of the urban areas is this, we have 1 meter for the entire apartment. And the usage of water by different households are different. And the person who actually uses very little water also has to pay for the usage of the one who uses large quantity of water, and nobody is responsible for it also. Nobody feels responsible for it. So this is a very good dimension of the usual meters of water, and very nice. And the regulation of having in-water harvesting structures imposed by the municipal body is also very interesting. But the only problem is that whether this are implemented properly. If there are every organization, Chennai, Delhi, everywhere, they have this regulation that you require a rainwater harvesting structure to get the occupancy certificate. But once the occupancy certificate is received, we never bother how it is maintained. So the maintenance is a major issue. So these are some of the challenges. These are some of the major challenges which we have to. So, I request secretary to UB's view, because this is a very new topic. We have so far dealing used to deal with rural areas, so we are now exposed to the realities of the urban sector. So, I request secretary to his comments on this.
Presentation actually. Sorry. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So, first of all, thank you very much, Vishwanath ji, for an excellent presentation. In fact, in the way back in 2019, as Ashok said, when we started this concept of water talk, basically it came to my mind after hearing some of the TED Talks. So I thought, why don't we talk about water? Because there are two things. One is that there is perhaps not enough even a knowledge about water. And second thing, there should be a platform where all stakeholders kind of join and start discussing about various issues of water and try to find a solution. So we started from there, and I was not very sure, Ashok was given this responsibility, I was not very sure how it will basically pan out in times to come. And I'm very happy that we have been doing this every month except March and April, when in May we switched off to this e-platform. And as Ashok was saying, this e-platform has enabled basically us to join more people. Of course, it's also Facebook Live, etc. is there. So the people can, even those who have not registered, also join. And this video is also available on our social media like Facebook, where people can watch it later also. So this has been very useful actually. And as before we went live today, as I was telling you, most of these talks have been, I would must say, very informative, very educative, and very inspiring as well. Because as you rightly, very beginning, you said that like Niti Aayog report, for example, you talked of. I keep talking to that. In fact, I say, thank God, 2020 summer is over actually. Otherwise, wherever I used to go to speak, people say, is it a fact that 21 cities of India, and they would not say, are going to run out of groundwater. They will ask me, are they going to run out of water? Even though it says groundwater. And then they say, as per a survey conducted by Niti Aayog. In fact, Niti Aayog did not conduct any survey actually. And then I used to tell people that there is no such thing. Yes, maybe there is an urgency, but there is no emergency. Let's not panic on this, because we have enough water actually. We manage water well. There is no reason for us that we will go a Cape Town way or something. So now at least these 21 cities, the 2020 is over, and none of the cities have ran out of a groundwater or water. So in a way, it's something which is good actually. What is the other thing? What happens is that a lot of people, basically, unfortunately, what happens is that negative discourse is always lapped up by people little more than the positive discourse actually. So kya hota hai ki koi bhi bolta hai ki nahi nahi hamara to pani khatam hone wala hai. Someone says that our requirement of water will double in so many years. Why should it double? My question is, just because population will double, that does not mean that requirement should double. We are so inefficient user of water that I always say that our inefficiency is our great strength actually. Our water use efficiency in agriculture, which consumes about 89% of water in the country, the water use efficiency is only 35 to 40%. So if we improve efficiency only by 10% or 15%, we have so much water actually. In cities, in India, we talk of non-revenue water to the extent of 40-50%. Very recently, I was making an inaugural speech in an India Water Innovation Summit just about 15-20 days back, when I had an Israel ambassador and when we had a Denmark ambassador with us. And Denmark ambassador was saying that their revenue, non-revenue water in Denmark is 4%. In India, I keep quoting of Jusco in Jamshedpur, which is a non-revenue water of 10% actually. Then they said that their water requirement has become half in last 20 years. USA, if my figures are correct, USA water requirement has not gone up in last so many years actually. So it is not that. It is not proper to say that, okay, water availability per capita is this much, and then someone defines a water stress, some foreigner draws a line, and basically we are basically talking all the time about that actually. So it's good. In fact, it's good that your presentation has been, I think, an eye-opener for many. Because whenever we talked about cities running out of groundwater, the first thing that came to my mind, first city which comes to my mind to everyone, is basically a city of Bangalore. And not many people know that so much has been done and so much is to be is being done. Of course, there's a lot to be done as it actually. Similarly, when they talk of lakes, none of these pictures come. What is that lake called? Belandur or something. So everybody will show basically picture of that and how the a fire catches in that Belandur lake actually. But then how many lakes have been revived and how many wells have been revived is a great story actually to tell. And that's why in addition to this water talk every month which we do, I am, me and Ashok sit for 2 hours every Saturday. From 3:30 to 5:30. And there basically we are asking people like district magistrate, municipal commissioners, and generally we also have one kind of a water activist or whether I should use the word activist or whatever, someone who works for water. Tomorrow is Saturday and 3:30 to 5:30 we would be sitting. And tomorrow we have a young a person, I would say young boy kind of Rambir Tanwar, who basically now he is known to almost everyone because of his pond renovation work actually. So tomorrow he would also be joining out of the four people who would be joining. He also would be joining actually. So in my opinion, certain good positive works are being done at one place. Should be actually told to the people. And as you very rightly said, in fact, yesterday I wrote up on my own Facebook page about today's talk. And then it says, whatever would be talked about Bangalore, is there nothing peculiar about Bangalore? Of course, there are certain peculiarities about every city. As you very rightly said, maybe a rainfall or that's located on a ridge or the kind of geology the city has. All these are also important. But by and large, problems and solutions are similar. The principles which has been applied in case of Bangalore as well could be applied for any other city, as you rightly said towards end of your talk, that you just replace the word Bangalore by any other city. But some of the points were very good in the sense that sometimes what happens that we don't talk of in an integrated fashion. Right from, as you said, regulations, a legal framework, to institutions. Institutions are very important. It's not only because all institutions are not as bad as sometimes made out to be. As your presentations has shown, our institutions in Bangalore, even government institutions in Bangalore, has done tremendously a good job actually. And then, of course, you talked about the community. We always say, in fact, that because without community involvement, in fact, today, buzzword, even for a ministry, is basically community participation of water or management, or particularly community participation of groundwater management. I have in these kind of forums earlier also talked about Atal Bhujal Yojana. Atal Bhujal Yojana is not a huge scheme. It's not like a Jal Jeevan Mission where there is a huge outlay. But what is most important is two things. One, it talks about participatory groundwater management. Participatory groundwater management in this country has been practiced since long, but on very small scale, mostly by non-government organizations who do it for 1 village, 2 village, 3 village, 10 village, 20 village. But India has more than 6 lakhs villages actually. So for the first time, a government is talking, which many of the non-government organizations are a little surprised also, that government which has been talking only of big dams and canals and all, is government is also talking of participatory groundwater management. We are also talking of how our villagers themselves should make measurement of water. They should know how much rainfall is falling there, how much is there, what is going inside the ground, how much they are extracting by way of a tube well or something. And then, not only that, based on that budget will show that it's a deficit budget actually. And so as we do a plan, so water security plan, that also should be done by the organizations like yours and all, and there are many such organizations. Number of I will say grassroots NGOs and community based organizations who are there to join hands with the government and do a lot of good things actually. So community involvement is also a very important which talked about. The one thing which you talked about, which I keep emphasizing every time, that we in today's when you get the water from a tap, sometimes we are forgetting the source. In the sense that, like today, I find that again today, last time, of course, large number of Kendriya Vidyalaya had joined. And I was just saying in chat, one or two children have written that I am from such and such Kendriya Vidyalaya joining as from Jammu and Kashmir. But then when you ask a boy and a girl in a school, where does the water come from? The chances are that he or she will say water comes from a tap. Maybe we have not tried to teach them what is an aquifer. Like you use the word confined aquifer. Now, what is confined aquifer? What is unconfined aquifer? What is it? Like I always felt that there is unlimited amount of water available under beneath this earth actually, and we can keep drawing the water actually. I never knew that there are areas now, and there are areas in country where we have withdrawn so much of groundwater that we have running the risk of running out of the water in the aquifers actually. So one should know about these kind of things actually. So this lakes which you talk or wells, I always say that if I again will agree with you that to the extent possible, we should basically rely on a local solution to a problem which in my opinion is a local problem. A drinking water should be a local problem, and even a city like Bangalore. Not many people, as you saw, an average rainfall is something like 970 millimeter, which is pretty good, I would say. Maybe it's a slightly less than the country average, which is more than a 1,000 millimeter. But in India also, we have areas where 200 and 250 millimeter rainfall we get actually. We know the story. Everybody talks of Israel's story. And it's a fact that Israel doesn't get more than a 300, 400 millimeter rainfall. Even in India, the much celebrated example is Hibre Bazar. Everybody talks of Popat Rao Pawar's initiative in Hibre Bazar. Hibre Bazar village gets a rainfall of not more than 400, 500 millimeter rainfall in an average year. And with that kind of, they manage everything. They manage their drinking water needs. They manage their irrigation needs. So there is no reason why in with 970 millimeter, we would not be able to manage drinking water requirement even of a densely populated city like Bangalore. Provided what Ashok says, we say, we catch the rain and hold it too. We need to catch the rain. In fact, just a month back, we have someone who gave a talk, Jyoti Sharma ji from a Force NGO. She was speaking actually. And then she talked about kind of a 5 R's actually. Not a 3 R, which generally we say ki of reduce and recycle and but then she added fourth one as recharge, and the fifth one says she said respect. That was basically respect for water. So I feel also that there is a time we start respecting our sources, be it wells, be it be it lakes, be it wetland. See, many of us, again, that's the problem where the ignorance comes. Many of us do not understand what is the importance of a wetland, actually. Or talk of, I always keep talking of floodplains, actually. Now, rivers. Now we are basically encroaching upon what belongs to the river. So floodplains. Now, what is the importance of floodplain? Not only in controlling flood, but holding the water. And that is the water which will come back to the river during the lean season. We do not understand that a groundwater becomes a source for a perennial river, because in India, unlike many other countries, our rivers are by and large all rain-fed rivers. Actually, we don't have very very few rivers. Maybe mainly in Indus system, if you say, water mainly comes from a snow melt kind of. But otherwise, all our rivers are by and large rain-fed rivers. Actually. And we get a lot of rainfall. Oh yes, I forgot. I was talking about last time's water talk was primarily she gave a data. She gave a data not on per capita water availability. She gave a data on per capita rainfall. On a particular city, how many people are there, what is the area of the city, and how much is the rainfall actually. And that figure comes a very huge actually. We talk in terms of 135 liter. Most of this, another matter, the city like Bangalore or Delhi or whichever city generally use much more than 135 liter. But otherwise, our norm says 135 liter per capita per day. And for that kind of requirement, rainfall is good enough actually. But it's a fact. Yes, I'm good. It's good that the government, the institutions, the non-government organizations, they all are joining hands in Bangalore to revive those traditional wells actually. Because we have already forgotten such a big tanks and ponds. And you say South always have this tradition of cascade of tanks actually. So it's good that not only so many, like you were talking of more than 1 lakh well or something, which has already been kind of either revived or is there. So rainwater harvesting, revival of traditional water bodies, which includes lakes also. And then one or two other things which Bangalore has done, I'm very happy in the sense that fine, most of the people feel that water is something which should come free because it's a God's gift. But then a good quality water at your doorstep is a service. And we must pay for the service because that is one way to ensure our efficient use. Otherwise, what happens today? Why is it that the Punjab and Haryana farmers started growing paddy, which they were not growing till 80? And I always say because of only two reasons. One reason was basically a free electricity so that you can pump as much water from the aquifers as you can. And the other what basically procurement policy of the government, which basically supports crops like paddy and paddy and wheat. In fact, today morning I was talking to our minister, who has been earlier a minister in agriculture also, and he's in the cabinet. So I say, sir, we were the country which were growing in many areas so much of millets, all kinds of whether it's a jowar, whether it's a bajra, whether it's a ragi, and they consume so much less water actually. But today, maybe our eating habits have changed, wrongly so. I'm happy that again we are talking back to our Nutri Millets and all, and that's being marketed. That's a very good development. But we also need to bring that into our procurement system actually, and a PDS system. And people will consume it. I'm not saying they entirely replace a paddy, replace a wheat or a rice with ragi or jowar. But it can be done. If you are giving 30 kg of rice, maybe it could be 25 kg of rice and 5 kg of ragi or something. In fact, when you are talking of Bangalore and Karnataka, everybody talks about Kaveri dispute. When I joined this ministry in 2017 as secretary, and before that, when I was a regional secretary also in 2016, every week, my boss then, secretary then, used to have a meeting with chief secretary of Karnataka and chief secretary of Tamil Nadu on, and Supreme Court, every 10 days, Supreme Court will say 10,000 water should be released from whichever you talked about, Krishna Sagar or Kavini or Hemavati or Harangini, these kind of reservoirs. And then Karnataka says, I need that water. How can I release it actually? And the kind of violence, the kind of everything took place. But then I read a very good article. I don't know who wrote that. He says solutions to Kaveri problem is ragi. And to a large extent, I agree that let's say even in a Kaveri Delta, people are used to growing three crops of paddy only actually. So there was a time when you did not have requirement upstream, you didn't have dam upstream, all the water flowing down to delta, then you can afford to grow three crops of a paddy. But today, perhaps we can't do it. And if we do it also, then we have to get into some other ways. We have to bring a technology. We have to bring in maybe a drip irrigation. We have to bring, maybe we have to take care of our structures. We have to take a non-structural measures to improve the water use efficiency. So there are a lot, of course, you talked about urban areas, but of course, as Ashok said, so far we have been talking more of our rural areas, but I find that urban areas problems today perhaps are more acute than the rural areas actually. And that's why in my weekly meeting with the district magistrates collectors, last time we have three municipal commissioners actually. And we deliberately got them actually because we find that the problems of water, the problems of lakes and ponds and tanks vanishing in city is much more than the rural areas, because that's obvious. Our pressure on a land is much more in the city actually. And as you also said, Ashok also said, many times people do not realize that these are the vanishing of these lakes and ponds and blocking the channels which used to carry water and concretizing everywhere is something which has led to urban flooding actually. Last year, a Patna got huge flood actually. A lot of people thought I belong to the place actually. So a lot of people thought that it's a Ganga water which has entered the city and that's why flood is there. No, Ganga was flowing and much below. It's the city water which was not going to come out because you have blocked everything. Either you have concretized so it is not able to percolate down. We have blocked the channels and those lakes and ponds and tanks, whichever they are in the city, they have just disappeared. Either they have been encroached upon, they have silted up, or they are basically being used as a receptacle for liquid and solid waste. So this is something where if the government, the institutions, the non-government organizations, community, and even individuals, if they all join hands, and I feel that if we can revive all our traditional water bodies, then half the problems would be solved. And as you very rightly said, what Bangalore has done, we must have a proper metering. We don't measure. For example, I don't measure. I generally know what is my electricity charges because the meter is proper, bill comes in time. So even if it's a summer, I switch off my AC, but then I switch on my AC, then maybe late in the night or 2 o'clock or something, I switch off my air conditioner so that the bill would be very high. Unfortunately, we don't do so for the water actually. Because in many cases, there is no proper metering, there is not proper measurement, billing comes on sea, like billings are not very regular. And it has to be, as in case of electricity, it has to be a telescopic kind of rate. And see, it need not be very huge, but then certain charges has to be there, reasonable charges. Otherwise, people would not become efficient as far as the use of water is concerned. The two last points which you said, I totally agree with you, is the wastewater. We are a country which has paid very least attention to wastewater. And whenever we talk of wastewater treatment, I always say people only talk of the how much wastewater is getting generated and what is the capacity we have created. Nobody even talks of how much water we are treating actually. That figure nobody keeps. They only say capacity has been created. But capacity creation is one thing, and its proper utilization and proper quality of treatment is another thing. So since these days, every month I have a meeting with all the states where I said, first of all, I started with data. No state has a proper data, unfortunately had a proper data, how many sewage treatment plants they have, where are they located, what technology it is based, what is its capacity, what is its capacity utilization for each sewage treatment plant, what is the quality of treatment and what is the treated water being used for. So at least a database by and large we have created, because there are a number of agencies working in each state actually. It's not one agency which takes care of the wastewater actually. But one good thing about, of course, there are some other cities also doing, some rural areas also being done. Haryana, Punjab today, because they face so much water problem, that wastewater is being used even in a rural areas for irrigation purposes. But of course, Karnataka, I'm aware of that. Karnataka or Bangalore is one of the best actually. Because you as you said, you use more than 450 MLD of water. And I remember the case which was filed in the Supreme Court also regarding the quality. So yes, maybe quality aspect naturally has to be taken into account, because aquifer, we would not like to pollute the aquifer, which is good actually. But I am told it has done a human service to the farmers in the real drought affected areas of Bangalore actually. So the wastewater treatment and wastewater utilization, we keep working. In fact, only 3-4 days back, we want to come out with a national a policy on a reuse of wastewater actually, which could be a guiding principle for the states. Because basically it's in the states, water, wastewater is in a state subject in India actually. So finally, action lies there. So we have developed that. We discussed the other day zero draft, and then we'll come with the first draft. We have experience of a number of states in India, and we also have experience from the many foreign countries actually. And basically, the tenet of that policy, the major plank of that policy would be that we must both. It should be mandate. Certain things have to be mandated, and certain things have to be incentivized. So both mandating and incentivizing should act. And lastly, what you talked about data, that's very important actually. Unfortunately, I keep getting with a lot of people keep saying that we don't have really data available in public domain. So reliable data in public domain. Of course, we are in the process of making fully functional something called a National Water Informatics Centers, where we want that data from all sources basically come at one platform, and that should be open to public domain. Otherwise, some data is with the CWC, some data with the CGWB, some data with the CPCB, and a lot of data with the states. And unfortunately, those don't sit on a platform, and those data don't talk to each other actually. So, but in a smaller way, all the cities, as you said in Bangalore, a lot of transparency of data is there, and a lot of data is available in public domain. Data is available on a real-time basis. So that's something which is very good. So I would must say your talk was very good, and many times even people who are in that sector and deal the subject day in and day out, we also do not know some of the best practices which is being done everywhere. And the idea of this kind of a water talk, and maybe my weekly dialogue with officers and water warriors, is also to bring to the focus good work which is being done. I always say, yes, we have a huge task at our hand, because ours is not a country. We are not a Singapore. We are not a we are not a Dubai or something. So our solutions, our problems, first of all, are many times bigger. And we have a different system of democracy. We have a federal structure. So it has its own limitations, problems, but it has its own advantages also. And lastly, I would only say, a lot of people would be watching, that this is something which water is too precious a thing. As someone said, that it should be only a government business, actually. It has to be everybody's business. And that's why Honorable Prime Minister, when he talked about 1.5 years, a little more than a year back, in I think it was May 2019, when he took over as Prime Minister of the country for the second time, and his Mann Ki Baat, he talked about 10-12 minutes only on water conservation and how glorious tradition of water harvesting which we have. As you very rightly said, way back in 1896 or something, you were showing that water management activity has started then only. And much earlier than also, Ashok has very recently compiled an excellent book which shows about 100 iconic step wells of India actually. And some of those step wells you see up, then we wonder, we marvel even at the architecture. Forget about this utility, but even how good they were built actually, and multi-purpose kind of thing. It could lead to even air conditioning, or people can go and just relax there, because maybe those people who are oppressed from the heat, they can go and sit down there. So when Honorable Prime Minister talked about this, then I always say that in our country, it's a PM, CM and DM. Centric. So when Prime Minister talks of something, a Chief Minister of a state something at a district level, and district magistrate makes a water as a priority, then things starts moving in a much faster manner actually. I'm not saying things were not being done, but the Prime Minister's nudge and our Jal Shakti Abhiyan last year and this year, in spite of pandemic, as Ashok said, we have a good kind of a work being done on the Catch the Rain campaign. So all that has made today. And it's good that a lot of people now are talking of water, finding innovative solutions of water, engaging community with the water. And we are also keep recognizing the people who has done good work in water, actually. So all that has created, in my opinion, a very positive atmosphere on which we have to build upon. So thank you very much to you, as well as to Ashok, as well as Anupma, for very efficiently organizing this water talk every month. And my thanks to all those who are basically right now either viewing this program, either by way of joining, registering and joining, or by way of watching it live on Facebook, etc. And now I hand over back to Ashok or Anupma, whoever conduct the balance of it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We will open this session for question answers. Krishna, are you ready for taking the questions? Okay, very good. So, Anupama, can we have open up this for question answer session?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon. Before proceeding further, I would like to introduce the format now. To ask your query, please click on the icon available on the top right side of your screen to raise your hand. Once you raise your hand, please wait for your name to be called. Introduce yourself first and your organization to ask your query. Now I request Mr. E. Surya Anudeep, you may please ask your query. I request again Mr. A. Surya Anudeep ji, you may please ask your query.
Hello, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes, please go ahead.
Go ahead.
Is there a connectivity problem or?
Now I request Mr. Amit Kumar Singh ji, you may please ask your query.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everybody. As Secretary sir has rightly said, we have to basically deal with inefficiencies. Like, you know, you have done a very small study in one of the area in Assam, in one of the cantonment. And just by, you know, removing the inefficiencies with the same manpower, I could save 30% of the water supply. So it is huge. There is a huge potential into this area. So I appreciate that. And I think we must basically look into this aspect, which is more cost economic, most core effective. Now, my question is, in Bangalore, there are a lot of water bodies, lot of water storage capacity. So the problem is not of water supply. The problem is of water mismanagement. So are we doing really something to, you know, manage that water? A lot of rainfall is there in Bangalore, which is spread over a particular, which is spread over a whole of the year. The point is only to channelize that water into these bodies. And another area which I'm looking into that is a lot of bore wells must be lying defunct, because the yield might have gone down, the water table might have gone down. We must use those bore wells as a ready infrastructure for groundwater recharge, particularly of the aquifer, which has got no water as on date. So your take on that?
Yeah. So let me answer the question quickly. There are many citizens groups and individuals who are fighting to save the lakes of Bangalore. They've even taken many of the matters to court. The challenge is that the lakes are under twin threats. One is the real estate prices have shot up so much that land has become precious. And so therefore, there's a lot of pressure on filling up the lakes and that, and getting wind on there. The second one is that it's become a place where wastewater starts to enter. And then when it becomes a breeding spot for mosquitoes and it becomes a smelly spot, then even the locals don't want the lakes to be around, right? So these two twin threats are now being realized. And ever since the 80s in Bangalore, right from the bird watching group to many other civil society groups, they've all pressurized the government, gone to the court, worked with the government in reviving the lakes, and so the process is going on. It's a slow process, but it's still going on. As regards bore wells, yes, the point is taken. And that's what is being done right now. It's attempted through the million well scheme to recharge not only the shallow aquifer, but also the different bore wells, which had yielded water once, to try and see whether it becomes a source again. Both these processes are on.
Now I request Mr. Jaipal Inanian ji, you may please ask your query.
Good afternoon, everyone. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Yeah. Can I speak in Hindi?
बिल्कुल
बिल्कुल जी, बिल्कुल बोलिए
जी। मेरा क्वेश्चन यूपी सर से है, सचिव सर से, कि हम, मैं राजस्थान नागौर से आता हूँ, तो वहाँ पर पानी की सबसे बड़ी ज्यादा समस्या है कि पानी का सब जो मेन सोर्स है वो है रेन वाटर, क्योंकि जो ग्राउंड वाटर है उसमें फ्लोराइड की समस्या है। तो हम जितना रेन वाटर को कंजर्व करेंगे उतना ही हमारे लिए सबसे बेस्ट। इसके लिए हमने पंचायत में, गाँव में इसके लिए होम बेसिस पे जो है पानी का संरक्षण करने का जो अभियान चलाया और उसमें होद में टैंक में स्टोर करते हैं। जैसा कि मैं अपने एग्जांपल देता हूँ, मेरे घर से हम 8 लोग हैं, उनके साल भर के लिए पीने का सबसे उपयुक्त पानी हमारे को मिल जाता है। इसके लिए मैंने गवर्नमेंट से भी रिक्वेस्ट किया है कि जैसे अभी सर ने बताया कि अटल भूजल योजना, तो क्या हम स्वच्छ भारत मिशन की तर्ज पे गवर्नमेंट सपोर्टेड वर्षा जल स्वावलंबन मिशन ला सकते हैं सर, जिससे हर एक आदमी को पीने योग्य स्वच्छ जल मिल सके, क्योंकि इस पे जो पूरा कंट्रोल इंडिविजुअल का होगा और किसी के ऊपर डिपेंडेंसी नहीं होगी, और ये भी एक तरह से आत्मनिर्भरता होगी सर पानी की, पेयजल के लिए।
नहीं देखिए, अच्छी बात है। सबसे पहले तो ये बात सही है कि जहाँ पे ज्यादा समस्या होती है वहां पे आदमी उसका सोल्यूशन भी ज्यादा आसानी से खोजता है। राजस्थान में चूंकि पानी की पहले से ही हमेशा कमी रही है, क्योंकि वहाँ बारिश कम होती है, तो वहाँ जैसा आपने बताया वहाँ का टंका सिस्टम की बात हम लोग हर समय कहते हैं कि कैसे आदमी छत पे पानी को इकट्ठा करके और उसको अपने टंका में डाल के अपनी रिक्वायरमेंट को पूरी करता है। अब ये तो बड़ी अच्छी बात है और इसे हर आदमी को करना चाहिए और लोग कर भी काफी रहे हैं। अब बात ये होती है कि इसके लिए जो आपने बात कही कि भाई इसके लिए या तो कुछ फाइनेंशियल असिस्टेंस की बात हो सकती है, जैसे अभी मैं पिछले वीक जब मैं बात कर रहा था तो म्यूनिसिपल कमिश्नर सूरत से थे, ऑफ कोर्स अर्बन एरिया के बारे में बता रहे थे, वहां पे 80-90% जो है वो सब्सिडी दी जाती है रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग के लिए। तो अभी तो रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग पर से, मतलब जो रूफटॉप रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग के लिए सरकार का कोई स्कीम ऐसा नहीं है, लेकिन फंड्स जो है वो डिफरेंट जगहों से आ सकते हैं। जैसे अभी हमने जल जीवन मिशन जो हमारा चल रहा है, जिसमें जल जीवन मिशन में ये है कि हर घर नल का जल पहुंचे, तो उसमें जो कई कंपोनेंट है, एक कंपोनेंट उसमें वो भी है सोर्स सस्टेनेबिलिटी, तो उसके अंदर भी सोर्स सस्टेनेबिलिटी में रेन वाटर, रूफटॉप रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग लिया जा सकता है। इस बार फाइनेंस कमीशन के पैसे हर ग्राम पंचायत को इस साल 30,000 करोड़ जाएंगे टायर्ड फंड्स, जो केवल जल और सैनिटेशन के लिए है। हर ग्राम पंचायत को उसमें से 15,000 करोड़ फाइनेंस कमीशन और फाइनेंस डिपार्टमेंट ने ऑलरेडी रिलीज कर दिया है। तो पंचायत के लेवल पे भी फंड्स जो है वो अवेलेबल है, जिस फंड्स का यूटिलाइज जो है वो किया जा सकता है। और बाकी अगर आपके जिले में, जैसे पिछली बार 1-2 सप्ताह पहले हमारे शो पे आई थी वडोदरा की कलेक्टर एक्चुअली शालिनी अग्रवाल ने 1,000 स्कूलों में रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग किया है बिना किसी स्कीम के। वहां पे उन्होंने इंडियन ऑयल कॉरपोरेशन, वहां पे दूसरे जो कंपनियां थी उनके जो CSR हैं उनसे भी उन्होंने कराया है। तो अगर पैसे की इतनी कमी नहीं पड़ती है, अगर अलग अलग मतलब किसी तरह से कन्वर्जेंस में, और इस बार ऐसा है कि अब जो नया गाइडलाइंस मनरेगा जो आप जानते हैं MGNREGA है, उसके नए गाइडलाइंस में रूफटॉप रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग भी एक परमिसिबल एक्टिविटी हो गई है। पहले परमिसिबल एक्टिविटी नहीं थी, वो भी हो गई है। तो हमारे ख्याल से अगर आपका, आपके जिला प्रशासन और बाकी लोग इसमें इंटरेस्ट लें तो फंड्स की ऐसी कोई कमी नहीं होनी चाहिए रूफटॉप रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग के लिए।
Now I request Mr. R. Madhavanji, you may please ask your query.
Yeah, good evening, sir. I'm R. Madhavan from Chennai. I am a student, this is second year from SRM. I think I am the only student here. You guys are... Yes, sir?
Please go ahead, go ahead. A lot of
students. Okay, sir. So, I got a lot of information from this, sir. What I want to say is, the youth participation is must, sir. But the water talks and these are happening, many don't know. I came to know by just, I got a mail from our college. If we can make it mandatory, then a small event or a 10 minutes or half an hour video event or something like that with the animation and a new technology and what we are doing and what we have to do like that. If we can create a video and if we can put in a My Government Twitter or something like that, yeah, we will got many people get knowledge about water and water management. So we should combine both our ancient and modern technologies together and find a solution for our water problem, water management. Our ancestors are very, actually I want to say they are brilliant. And they used a waste water very, just now got to know about the Stepwell book. I seen last 2 weeks back, I got really inspired about that. Because I went to Gujarat and saw 2 to 3 Stepwells. And I got really inspired about the architecture and water management. If we can promote with tourism basis, like if we, a day only for Stepwells, architecture students can also get more knowledge about this, and environment students, like that, similar students can get more knowledge about this, and we can promote it. If we want to promote it, that's because we are doing many things, but it is not appealing to the public. If we promote, like we can put ads, we are putting ads, but it is only visible in Doordarshan or similar activity. It is not visible like in Star Sports or in Star TV or Sun TV like that. If we put ads in big TVs or big channels that most people are watching, that will attract more of us. And we can conduct a innovation campaign for all the young entrepreneurs.
Okay, fine. No, thank you very much. I would like to cut you short because there are many others people who would be waiting actually. No, first of all, thank you very much for your suggestion, but for your kind information. You are not the only one student. Maybe I do not know how many college students, but very good number of school students, especially students from Kendriya Vidyalaya, and their teachers are also right now connected with us. I very rightly said that not only youth, but you say catch them young actually. And in fact, when I was talking about 1,000 schools being fitted with having a functional rainwater harvesting, one of the purpose is that while the rainwater harvesting is put up, it will at least educate in that school. If the school has, let's say, a 500 boys or girls, then 500 boys and girls will learn what is a rainwater harvesting, what is the need for a rainwater harvesting, where does this water which we harvest from a roof, where does it go? So they will come to know how to aquifer. So a lot of learning would be to them also. But as I think Mr. Vishwanath also very briefly, he didn't get the time to speak much of it, but a water literacy is something which is very, very important actually. And perhaps we need to do a lot with the help of either a community-based organization, non-government organizations, or institutions like BIOM actually, as far as to increase the water literacy. But anyway, thank you very much for taking the interest and coming with a valuable suggestion. Thank you.
So we are also planning involving Nehru Yuva Kendra as well. We will be, in a month's time, we'll be involving all of them. So you can join as a part of that campaign. So we may be starting a lot of IEC activities involving Nehru Yuva Kendras and all this. Okay, good suggestions, Madhav. Next question.
Yeah, now I request Mr. Shirish Apteji, you may please ask your query.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Go ahead.
Mr. Vishwanath, you have done an excellent job in Bangalore regarding this water conservation and community participation. I have just a small suggestion. As you said in your presentation, that the cost of providing water to Bangalore city is very high. So I request you kindly look into the matter of whether the power supply can be shifted to solar power. So in 4 years, 5 years, you will certainly recover the cost, and the water supply cost will come down. You can also use PPP model for that. So that will, you will be switching over to green power, and that will save you a lot of money. Secondly, as Honorable Secretary has suggested during his presentation, that the cost of the losses within the city pipeline is very high. Unmetered water is very, very high percentage of unmetered water in many urban areas in our country. So kindly conduct a water auditing of this pipeline network. And all the best for your excellent work.
Thank you. Noted. We'll convey the.
Yeah, Fine, a couple of things which you said, we are also planning a few things actually. Like for example, you said water audit. The way energy audit is done, unfortunately, we don't do a water audit as well actually. Similarly, there is a kind of a, all the companies disclose how much energy, let us say, they consume per unit of, let's say, steel produced or per unit of something else produced. We don't do it generally for the water actually, because water use efficiency should also be a very important parameter for the industries. In fact, we are talking in terms of something like introducing a scheme like PAT. There is in electricity sector, there's a perform, achieve and trade, where a particular levels are fixed for, let's say, next 3 years for an industry. So similarly, we should also have what is their present norm of consumption and how do they proceed 1 year from hence, 2 years from hence, 3 years from hence. And lastly, we are also thinking in terms of, in fact, the other day we discussed introducing a concept like, as you have renewable energy certificates. So something like a reuse certificate for water actually, because certain mandate, certain reuse would be mandated, and those who are not able to do it, they will have to purchase a reuse certificate, and those who do more of a reuse can perhaps sell that. So there are quite innovative strategy we need to adopt to make basically a more efficient use of water. Thank you, Vishwanath. You wanted to add something? I'm sorry, I perhaps interrupted you.
Not at all. Since the suggestion was to the BWSSB, I would put up the matter to them. And the other aspect of, we are lucky in Bangalore because we have retail meters. So therefore, there's a sense of how much is the actual loss, because many towns and cities are only guessing how much is the loss, right? The non-revenue water. So the BWSSB has taken up bulk metering also, and in many zones has started to reduce the water losses. It has come down from 50% to 34%. The target is to push it towards 20%, but the incremental gains from 34 to 20 is going to take a long time and a lot of investment in leaking pipe repairs and many other things, right? But that process is on.
Now I request Mr. Uday Kelkaji, you may please ask your query.
Good afternoon, sir. I see you're smiling. Good afternoon, Ashok. I just wanted to add, I'm not going to ask a question. Just this is to Mr. Vishwanath. I've been fortunate to work with BWSSB since 2007. They have done a lot of work. And if you look at it, recycle, reuse, I'm really glad you brought all aspects of water, including rainwater, reduction in NRW, recycle, reuse, and everything else. They have done a work, and I was part of that instrumental work that was approved by CPHO for building the plant. And I'm glad to say that the plant is now getting built to put a water back to Arkavati, bring it to the TG Halli Reservoir, and use it from TG Halli Reservoir back to the system. There was one point when Arkavati water was being dwindled because of low water. You're going to pump it from V Valley area, and the head loss between the V Valley and the Arkavati is only 50 meters. So the cost of pumping is absolutely low as compared to 450 meters bringing from TK Halli all the way to the city. And you can do that. And BWSSB is really looking at recycle, reuse. And under USAID funding, we had done a lot of mandatory work on that. What is missing out of there is public participation and knowledge-based dissemination to the politicians, to the legislators, to the systems. People are getting knowledgeable. Bangalore is the top city of IT in India and understands. So we just need to have that, and combining all that, it's a beautiful one. Bangalore can be the leader in IPR, indirect portable reuse. Thank you, sir.
Just a quick response.
Second, Kilkerti, the one suggestions, of course, of yours is very valuable. In fact, I think we should also not only take our water literacy in schools and colleges, we should have some kind of a water literacy. I perhaps we will have to coin some other word actually for honorable, maybe a public representatives actually, because after all, in a democratic country, if they think that the water is on top of their agenda, then a lot of things will automatically get sorted out actually. Thank you.
Yeah, I just had one point to add. Actually, the whole treated wastewater transfer from Bangalore to the districts of Kolar, Chikballapur, and now Ramnagaram and Bangalore rural has been politically driven. It's Mr. Krishna Bhairi Gowda, who was the then Minister for Agriculture, and Mr. Ramesh Kumar, who was the Speaker, were the key architects behind the scheme. So you'd be surprised. It's not the politicians who need education as much as we citizens and experts, you know, Experts tend to live in a cocoon. Experts develop plans. Experts have also to get to the people, and experts have to tell people what the merits and demerits of a plan are, right? It's always easy to find the politician as a lightning rod for all those problems. Actually, their ears are on the ground and they're doing a wonderful job. But I agree with all your points today.
Now I request Mr. Srikant Janardhanan ji, you may please ask your query.
Thank you, Vishwanath ji. Very nice and very relevant talk in the wake of the Niti Aayog report, as Secretary pointed out, which states 21 cities are going to run out of groundwater this very year. I'm Srikant from CSIRO Australia. You may know that Australia is also in the middle of a drought, and we are also investing in what we call as the managed aquifer recharge, which is an umbrella term for all the kind of activities you mentioned. So I'm curious about the community level water balance that you talked about. Very likely that such communities where they are very judicious and they have a water budget or water balance, they are creating a groundwater mound in the area, but very likely that it is depleted by communities around the region who don't monitor or who are not as judicious as this community is. So I was wondering if there's an aquifer level water balance for the shallow aquifer in the Bangalore region, and are there plans for, As Secretary pointed out, mandated water resources plans. We call it water sharing plans or water resources plans in Australia, which are kind of legal instruments under the Water Act for assessing and managing these aquifers. So, is that in the list of things, or is currently being done in Karnataka in general and Bangalore?
Yeah. So to quickly answer you. CICERO is a world-renowned organization, so we all know about CSIRO, so it's wonderful. And we hope that your budget does not get more constrained than it is already getting constrained. But that aside, groundwater is a bit undercooked in India in terms of management and governance, and especially urban groundwater is even more undercooked and undermanaged. There's a lot that needs to be done. Thanks to the Atal Bhujal Yojana, we'll get a lot of understanding and management paradigms for rural groundwater. But in urban areas, we'll have to do a bit more focusing. In the particular case of Rainbow Drive, thanks to a very nice group called AquaDam, led by Dr. Manshu Kulkarni and team, we did something called a participatory groundwater management plan there and a participatory understanding of the aquifers in that particular area. We're lucky to say that the groundwater mound you talked about, to the extent of about 60-80%, benefits the locality itself. It's a quirk of the sub-aquifer which has resulted in that. But you're right, the negative externalities of groundwater recharge need to be managed at a larger scale. And we need to understand the sub-aquifer boundaries. That work, unfortunately, is not happening enough from the groundwater authority in Bangalore. So it's being mostly driven by civil society and academia. Hopefully, it will get ingrained in the groundwater authority itself, and the groundwater authority will become more competent, more proficient, and more invested in understanding the aquifers of Bangalore and then managing it better. But that's a bit of a long haul.
Can I? I would like to add something on it. The one is that, of course, the kind of importance which the groundwater should have got in the discourse had been lacking for quite some time, actually. Because even today, if you ask the people that what has brought the India's green revolution, the people would talk only of our dams and canals, actually. But if you really see the contribution which has been made by the groundwater is much more. In fact, we keep saying the data that today in country about 65% of irrigation needs are actually met by the groundwater. About 85% of the rural drinking water needs are met from the groundwater. About 50% of urban drinking water needs are also met from the groundwater. Of course, it will vary from city to city. And even industrial water, about 50% met from the groundwater. Not many people know that even a state like Punjab, which has so many dams and so much of canals, they are something like a 73 or 77% of total irrigation water needs are met from groundwater, actually. So these days now we have brought at least the groundwater in focus, actually. People have started talking, maybe because sustainability has become a problem. So we have started talking of groundwater much more in our discourse and talking about the groundwater recharge and all this water bursting and water security plan.
But as you rightly said, so we are not earlier what was being done, as you rightly said, maybe some non-government organization has done it in one or two kind of villages. Now we have taken, I would not say that it is basically a sub-basin or one aquifer kind of, still is not the basis, because in India problem is that everything the basis is usually administrative unit actually. In fact, we have also been talking for quite some time of having a river basin authority actually, but you know there are problems because water being in a state subject constitutionally, there are issues on that. But then we have not taken kind of one village here, one village elsewhere. We have taken basically a group of villages. Maybe if I'm taking a block, most of the village in that block. So chances are that they are part of one aquifer actually. But as you rightly said, not that the aquifer has not become, or a basin, sub-basin has not become still a unit for the planning, which would be optimum thing. But then there are a lot of organizations which has Aqua Dam he was talking of, Himanshu Kulkarni, who keeps talking of either bringing water to the aquifer, people to the aquifer, aquifer to the people kind of. But there are many organizations. For example, let's say I know in Pune itself, I know an organization, I think it's called WOTR, which is doing this kind of a water bursting and kind of a concept in more than 100 villages actually. They have already done it actually. So I think it's something which is good, but optimally, if we make up some kind of hydrological unit as a unit of planning, that would certainly be better than an administrative unit. Thank you very much. And thank you for joining all the way from Australia.
Now I request Mr. Ronak Sharma, you may please ask your query.
मैं रौनक शर्मा केवी बंतलाव जम्मू सर मैं क्लास 8 में पढ़ता हूँ सर मेरी क्वायरी एक्चुअली ये है कि अभी तक तो मैं जम्मू में पढ़ रहा था पर इस कोविड इरा में मैं अपने होम टाउन में आया मैंने यहाँ ना एक बात नोटिस की कि यहाँ वाटर को लेके ना मतलब यहाँ वाटर की कमी तो नहीं है पर यहाँ मतलब वाटर्स को जो वाटर है मतलब लोग पब्लिक स्टैंड यूज़ करते हैं अपने घर तक वाटर ले जाने के लिए सर मेरे को आपकी थोड़ी सी हेल्प चाहिए कि हम इसको इम्प्रूव कैसे करें कि मतलब हम उस पानी को यूज़ कर सकें जैसे यहाँ स्प्रिंग वाटर जो है वो 1 किलोमीटर 2 किलोमीटर आगे जो है मतलब स्किप कर करके मतलब आपको वाटर मिल ही जाता है इतने सारे स्प्रिंग्स हैं यहाँ सर मतलब माउंटेन एरिया में यहाँ वाटर की कमी नहीं है पर उसको कोई यूज नहीं कर रहा यहाँ ना हाउसेस बने हैं ना पीएचडी डिपार्टमेंट बने हैं सर यहाँ मतलब बनाने के लिए कि घरों तक वाटर पहुँचाए सोसाइटी तक पहुँचाए यहाँ रूरल एरियाज में यही प्रॉब्लम है यहाँ ज़्यादा डेवलपमेंट नहीं है सर सर रोड भी यहाँ बहुत टाइम बाद आए तो सर हम इसमें डेवलपमेंट कैसे कर सकते हैं इधर हाउसेस बनाने की रिक्वेस्ट कैसे कर सकते हैं क्योंकि लोग तो फिर भी तब भी पब्लिक स्टैंड का यूज़ कर रहे हैं और जो वाटर स्प्रिंग वगैरह स्प्रिंग्स के वाटर हैं वो तो मतलब वेस्ट हो रहे हैं एक टाइप से वो कहीं जाके इकट्ठा हो रहे हैं फिर गंदगी हो रही है उसमें फिर उसमें वेस्ट वाटर ट्रीटमेंट प्लांट में भी वो यूज़ नहीं होते सर और एक और सजेशन है कि जैसे मतलब जो लोग होते हैं उन बच्चे जो होते हैं सर वो नेशनल्स वगैरह में जाते हैं साइंस कंपटीशन में उधर मेनली 5 to 6 टॉपिक्स होते हैं जिसके अंडर आपको प्रोजेक्ट बनाने होते हैं सर पर उसमें से वाटर कोई टॉपिक नहीं होता तो उस वाटर को भी एक मेन टॉपिक रख के वाटर लिटरेसी के बारे में पढ़ाया जाए और सर मीन्स इस टाइप से वाटर को लोग सीरियसली लेंगे और जो स्टूडेंट्स हैं वो भी इसके बारे में सोचना शुरू करेंगे थैंक यू सर
ठीक है रौनक बहुत थैंक्स अ लॉट टू यू मैं तो कुछ बोलने वाला था कि भाई कोई हमारे साथ इतने जो स्टूडेंट जुड़े हुए हैं या टीचर जुड़े हुए हैं केंद्रीय विद्यालय से उनमें कोई क्यों बात नहीं कर रहा है तो चलिए ऐसा है कि पहली बात तो जो ये हम अभी हम सोच रहे हैं कि भाई पहाड़ों में पानी की कोई कमी नहीं है और चूंकि बारिश वहाँ बहुत होती है ये भी मिथ जो है वो कुछ दिन में खत्म हो जाएगा मैं जिस इलाके से आता था बिहार के मैं जिस प्लेन से आता था तो वहाँ मैं भी सोचता था कि हमारे यहाँ कभी पानी की कमी नहीं होगी बरसात के दिनों में इतना पानी हो जाता था कि लोग कुएं में गिर जाते थे क्योंकि रास्ता और कुआं अलग अलग नहीं दिखता था आज वहां के कुओं में भी पानी खत्म हो गया है आपको शायद मतलब सुन के अच्छा नहीं लगेगा क्योंकि हमारा तो मेन सोर्स जो है जैसे गंगा है तो गंगा की जो मेन स्ट्रीम जो है वो भागीरथी है अलकनंदा भागीरथी का 60% पानी कहाँ से आता है वो पानी जो आता है 60% पानी वो आता है स्प्रिंग से स्प्रिंग्स जो आपने बताया ना, स्प्रिंग्स आर सो इम्पोर्टेंट, बट स्प्रिंग्स का क्या हो रहा है, मोर देन 50% स्प्रिंग्स जो हैं या तो ड्राई अप हो गए हैं या जो पहले पेरेनियल थे वो अब सेमी पेरेनियल हो गए हैं एक्चुअली। तो इसलिए स्प्रिंग का रेजुविनेशन बहुत जरूरी है। उसमें तो आप जैसे स्टूडेंट हो, उसमें सबसे बड़ी चीज होती है कि स्प्रिंग में पानी कहाँ से निकलता है ये तो पता चलता है, लेकिन उसका जो उसको हम डिस्चार्ज जोन बोलते हैं, जो रिचार्ज जोन है पानी क्या, उसको रिचार्ज जोन, उसके लिए एक आइसोटोप स्टडी की जाती है एक्चुअली, जिससे ये पहले पता करना होता है कि रिचार्ज जोन कहाँ पे है। तो एक तो मैं ये कमेंट ही कहना चाहता था कि ऐसा नहीं है कि पानी की पहाड़ों में कमी नहीं है, बहुत सारी एरिया हैं जहाँ की पानी, बारिश बहुत होती है, पहाड़ी एरिया है, लेकिन वहां भी पानी की कमी हो गई है। लेकिन दूसरा पॉइंट आपने सही बताया कि हमारा जो ये रहता है कि हम हमेशा पहले सप्लाई साइड मैनेजमेंट की बात करते थे, हम डिमांड साइड मैनेजमेंट की बात बहुत कम करते हैं एक्चुअली। तो जो पहले भी बताया गया कि जो इफिशियंसी इंक्रीज करना है वो डिमांड साइड मैनेजमेंट है, कैच द रेन सप्लाई साइड मैनेजमेंट है, लेकिन पानी को जितना खर्चा करना चाहिए उससे ज्यादा खर्चा करते हैं। हाँ, कहीं पानी बह रहा है तो हम बहने देते हैं, टैप चल रहा है तो हम चलने देते हैं, लीक हो रहा है तो लीक होने देते हैं हम, ये सारा कुछ जो है जिसको हम बोलते हैं डिमांड साइड मैनेजमेंट। जब कहीं भी बजटिंग होती है, कंट्री की हो या घर की भी बजटिंग होती है, तो उसमें या तो हम इनकम बढ़ाएंगे, इनकम बढ़ाने की एक लिमिट होती है, उससे ज्यादा हम इनकम नहीं बढ़ा सकते हैं, तो हम क्या करेंगे, हम खर्चा घटाएंगे। तो खर्चा घटाना जो डिमांड साइड मैनेजमेंट है, तो वो हम यही जो आपने बताया उसके से हम कर सकते हैं। और आपका सजेशन बहुत अच्छा है, हमने अभी धीरे धीरे कोशिश की है कि हम पानी के में कैसे मतलब बच्चों के बीच मतलब प्रतिस्पर्धा थोड़ा अच्छा लाएं, वो वाटर के इनोवेटिव चीजों पर कैसे काम करें, उस पर भी हम और भी आगे मतलब काम करना चाहेंगे। आपका सजेशन बहुत अच्छा है, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
सर आई थिंक टाइम इज रनिंग आउट, सर 5 o'clock विल क्लोज द प्रोग्राम। सर कैन वी क्लोज द प्रोग्राम नाउ, इट्स ऑलमोस्ट 2 hours सर, 5 o'clock वी कैन क्लोज इट सर।
श्योर, बट my request is that all those who फिर क्यों इतनी आवाज आ रही है भाई अनुपमा जी, ऐसा तो कोई नहीं है 5 बजे के बाद जो है वो जानबूझ के डिस्टर्बेंस डाल दिया गया है कि हम आगे बात ना कर सके।
अशोक सर, I request you to kindly mute.
क्वेश्चन पूछा या आपने हमें चैट में या मैसेज में कमेंट्स में, मैं तो कोशिश करता हूँ कि मुझे तो अभी देखा कि हमने बहुत सारे कमेंट्स, जब से स्टूडेंट्स जुड़ने लगे हैं तो काफी सारे कमेंट्स आने लगे हैं एक्चुअली। तो हम तो कोशिश करते हैं कि कमेंट्स भी अगर कुछ अच्छा है तो उसको एक बार देखें, बिकॉज दैट बिकम्स अ वेरी गुड फीडबैक फॉर अस एक्चुअली। हमने अपने ऑफिसर से भी कहा है कि भाई जो कमेंट्स चाहे वो अभी फेसबुक लाइव से हो या बाद में भी उस पर कमेंट आए उसको देखें। तो आपका कोई भी सजेशंस होगा, अब अशोक तो पहले भी अनाउंस करता रहा है, देयर आर ईमेल आईडी ही विल से, उस पर भी आप अपने क्वेरीज भी भेज सकते हैं, आप अपने जो 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 आपके सजेशंस हैं उसको भी भेज सकते हैं। और हमारा जो कुछ सोशल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म्स हैं, जैसे हमारा फेसबुक है या इंस्टाग्राम है, इस पर भी आप जाके अपनी स्टोरी भी दे सकते हैं, अपने सजेशंस भी दे सकते हैं। और आज का जो लाइव जो टेलीकास्ट हुआ है, लाइव स्ट्रीमिंग हुई है, उसके नीचे भी आप अपने कमेंट्स या सजेशंस दे सकते हैं। थैंक यू वेरी मच, बैक टू यू अशोक।
थैंक यू सर। एक्चुअली जैसे सेक्रेटरी साहब ने बताया, क्वेश्चंस हम कलेक्ट करते हैं सर, वो जो जो कमेंट्स जितने भी आते हैं उसी में से क्वेश्चंस, कमेंट्स तो बहुत होते हैं, बट क्वेश्चंस, रिलेवेंट क्वेश्चंस का हम आंसर देके अपने वेबसाइट में डालते हैं सर। इट विल बी अवेलेबल इन आवर एज फ्रीक्वेंटली एज क्वेश्चंस वी पुट अप इन द वेबसाइट, सो दे कैन आल्सो चेक अप सर। इंडिविजुअली इतने लोगों को रिप्लाई देना मुश्किल होगा, सो कॉमन क्वेश्चंस इकट्ठा करके, कॉमन क्वेश्चंस करके वी पुट इन आवर वेबसाइट सर, हम करते रहते हैं सर।
अशोक, अगर आपके FAQ टाइप की चीज नहीं है तो प्लीज डू दैट। जो FAQ होता है कि बाय दिस टाइम अभी वी हैव अ गुड क्वेश्चन बैंक ऑलरेडी अवेलेबल एक्चुअली, तो उसके बेसिस पे एक FAQ करके वेबसाइट पे डाल दो अगर नहीं डाला है तो।
जितने भी वेबिनार्स हुआ करता था उसी में ऐसे क्वेश्चंस लेके हमने वी हैव पुट इट अप इन द वेबसाइट सर। जो जो नए नए क्वेश्चन आते हैं उसको भी ऐड कर देंगे सर. एनीवे सर थैंक्स फॉर दिस वंडरफुल टॉक सर. जैसे सर ने बताया वी हैव एक्चुअली वी वांटेड टू कलेक्ट दिस टाइप ऑफ बेस्ट प्रैक्टिसेस एंड पुट इन अ प्लेटफॉर्म सो दैट अदर्स कैन लर्न फ्रॉम हिम विद दिस एक्सपीरियंसेस वेरियस पीपल. तो नेशनल वाटर मिशन ने एक ईमेल तैयार रखा है catchtherain@gmail.com. आप सब नोट कर लीजिएगा. इसी टू रिमेम्बर है हमारे कैंपेन का नाम है catchtherain है .nwm नेशनल वाटर मिशन catchtherain@gmail.com. जीमेल सबसे पॉपुलर ईमेल आईडी है. तो इस पते पर आप अपना सजेशंस दे सकते हैं. आपने कहीं आपके एरिया में कुछ अच्छा काम देखा हो उसी को भेज सकते हैं या कोई आइडियाज आपके है वाटर कंजर्वेशन के बारे में या वाटर सेव करने के बारे में या अच्छा फोटोज भेज सकते हैं. ये सब डिटेल्स आप इस ईमेल में भेज दीजिएगा catchtherain@nwm@gmail.com. वील कलेक्टेड अपने वेबसाइट एनडब्ल्यूएम के वेबसाइट में catchtherain के एक सेपरेट फोल्डर ही है उसी में जहां से भी हम कोई अच्छे फोटोग्राफ्स या कंजर्वेशन प्रैक्टिसेस मिलते हैं उसी को डालते हैं ताकि ये लोग दूसरे लोग उसको देखे इंस्पायर हो जाएं. तो दैट इज व्हाट वी आर बीन डूइंग. सो आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू एनसीएस आल्सो टू सेंड योर सजेशंस और योर गुड प्रैक्टिसेस यू सी इन योर स्कूल और इन योर नेबरहुड. आप फोटो भेज के लेके हमारा वेबसाइट ईमेल एड्रेस दे दीजिएगा. थैंक्स अ लॉट. आई थैंक आवर स्पीकर विश्वनाथ श्रीकांत अय्या हू हैड डन अ एक्सीलेंट प्रेजेंटेशन टुडे. वेरी डिटेल्ड टेक्निकल प्रेजेंटेशन कटिंग अक्रॉस एंटायर स्पेक्ट्रम ऑफ द पीपल हू आर वाचिंग दिस प्रोग्राम. हमारा कई कई समटाइम्स वी आर वी यूज्ड टू टेल द स्पीकर दैट इट इज एक्चुअली मेंट फॉर स्टूडेंट्स. सो सी लेवल पे आया करता था प्रेजेंटेशन. This time, your presentation had cut across all range of people, right from technical people to the students. Sabko samajhne mein yaar very very easy language mein you have told. They're very thankful to you, and we continue to look forward to your cooperation in the rainwater harvesting structures. Bangalore is an inspirational model, so we hope that the people who watch this program are. We'll be inspired by it, and then we'll take forward whatever your suggestions you had given. We'll put it in our website and also take to the appropriate authority. Once again, I thank Mr. Vishwanath for giving this wonderful talk. Normally, we used to present the book when you used to have it in the physical water talk, but abhi aajkal kuch nahi kar sakte, so we'll send you an e-book which would be as a token of appreciation and gratitude which you had given us. Thank you, Mr. Vishnu. I also would like to take the opportunity to tell the viewers, maybe log is webinar mein hai, that we have tomorrow also at 3:30 another webinar where we take inputs from various DMs. Hamara kal ke talk mein Mr. Srikant, who is the district magistrate of Latur. Latur, aap sab jante hai ki it is a very drought prone area. Wahan pe काफी काम वाटर में किया गया है. इनफैक्ट वी हैड वन ऑफ द पर्सन हु हैड अटेंडेड वन ऑफ आवर टॉक वाज मिस्टर दत्ता पटेल हु इज द डायरेक्ट इंजीनियरिंग याहू. ही हैड कम एंड डिड लॉट ऑफ वर्क इन लातूर एरिया. सो वी हैव इनवाइटेड मिस्टर श्रीकांत हु इज द डिस्ट्रिक्ट मजिस्ट्रेट लातूर. ही विल बी प्रेजेंट टुमारो इन आवर डायलॉग विद डिस्ट्रिक्ट. एंड वी हैव मिस्टर सुशील कुमार पटेल हु इज द डीएम ऑफ मिर्जापुर. उन्होंने भी वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग में काम किया था. ही विल आल्सो बी प्रेजेंटिंग हिज वर्क. एंड वी आल्सो हैव मिस दिव्या अय्यर हु इज द एमडी ऑफ द मिशन डायरेक्टर ऑफ द मनरेगा प्रोग्राम्स इन स्टेट बिकॉज केरला स्टेट में भी काफी काम किया है रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग स्ट्रक्चर्स में. दे हैव देयर ओन लोकल प्रोग्राम्स आल्सो. उसी के बारे में बताएंगे. एंड देन वी हैव मिस्टर रामवीर तनवर हु इज द फाउंडर ऑफ द सेव अर्थ फाउंडेशन इन ग्रेटर नोएडा. सो ये तीनों महाशयम एंड ऑफकोर्स सेक्रेटरी सर विल बी देयर एंड वी ऑल विल बी देयर फॉर द टॉक. सो इफ यू आर इंटरेस्टेड टू जॉइन अस टुमारो प्लीज जॉइन अस एट 3:30 फॉर दिस डायलॉग विद द डिस्ट्रिक्ट. द वेबसाइट nwm.gov.in में यू कैन गेट द लिंक ऑल्सो. कैन फॉलो अस इन फेसबुक ऑल्सो सो दैट यू कैन बी अ पार्ट ऑफ दैट प्रोग्राम.
I thank Anupama from the Water Digest for giving us his technical assistance and platform. I thank the Secretary Sir for sparing his valuable time for 2 hours, almost 2 hours, very valuable time of Secretary of Government of India to sit with us and guide us and inspire us. I thank the Secretary Sir for giving his suggestions and also valuable inputs for this program. I thank all the participants who have taken time to attend this program. Thanks a lot. We'll meet you for the next Water Talk next Friday, third Friday of the month. Or if you want to interested in attending the dialogue with district every Saturday, 3:30 to 5:30. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. I would just like to add here, sir, it's an honor to be part of this initiative with the ministry. And I had been reading so many comments here, and I was really wanting to, kind of say, sir, one more question from audience-sized participant side. But unfortunately, due to paucity of time, we couldn't take much. But let me tell you that there had been wonderful comments coming from a lot of teachers also, like sir mentioned. So sir, they had been appreciating this initiative, and they had been saying that it is one of the steps for water literacy. And the others are also wanting to know more about such programs which can be done for the students and all. So through this platform, I would also like to tell them that, we keep doing a lot of work for students, a lot of such training programs. So maybe they can also follow Water Digest along with ministry's website, so that together we work for one cause, which is furthering the cause of water. Thank you so much, Secretary Sir. Thank you so much, Ashok Ji. Thank you so much, Vishwanath Ji, for joining us. Thank you so much.